thanks to the Law and Religion Society and to Stanley for inviting me up. I enjoy being in New York City. We don't get to do this very frequently, so appreciate the opportunity. I'm an attorney with Alliance Defending Freedom, senior counsel with Alliance Defending Freedom, and I know that several ADF attorneys, I think, have been here in recent months, but we are an organization that litigates in sanctity of life, religious liberty, and marriage in the family areas. We also have a global team that Laura Miranda, my colleague, is on, working here in New York City. I just wanted to thank you for having me here to talk about what I think is one of the most important Supreme Court cases in the last couple of decades, about what it means for current and the future debates on the abortion question. I'm mindful of the fact that a great many of you probably disagree with me pretty deeply about the abortion issue, both about its morality, and certainly what the Constitution says about it, and that's to be expected. This is, without any doubt, at least one of, if not the most significant jurisprudential questions that we face for the last four decades or so in our country. It's in fact shaped other jurisprudential debates. The entire doctrine of stare decisis, and if you are attempting to address the question of stare decisis in any brief anywhere and you don't cite Planned Parenthood versus Casey, you're probably doing it wrong. It's impacting a lot of different areas of the law. It certainly impacts our politics. It has completely shaped, I think, and we can maybe talk about this later on. It's not part of my main talk, but we can talk about this later on. I think it's completely shaped the way the modern political parties even operate, this one particular question that we're dealing with, in ways that may be, in fact, good and bad for whichever party it is that you support. So given the moral, legal, and political stakes of this debate, it should inspire some passion. If you can't get worked up about abortion and form some firm opinions about this particular question, you probably can't get too worked up about very many things. Where better than one of the nation's top law schools to have that conversation? Lawyers can't actually evaluate these questions in good faith, and there's not much hope for the rest of society. So it's very possible that some of you may be on the same or the opposite side for me in one of these cases, one of these issues going forward. So hopefully we can find some understanding of what the arguments are, even if we completely disagree on the outcomes. I believe that Planned Parenthood versus Casey, no relation, by the way, despite my name, was wrongly decided. I believe it's one of the worst decisions in the history of the Supreme Court, both on moral and jurisprudential grounds. I think one could make a very strong case that it's the worst decision in the history of the Supreme Court, worse than Roe itself, which I would also say is wrongly decided. I'll provide some basic thoughts on why I believe that's the case. I'll also explain what I think the future holds for Casey, as well as how it's shaping or will be shaped by the current debates that are ongoing around the country. Several lawsuits, a number of lawsuits, and a number of statutes that will be challenged concerning the abortion question. So what did Casey hold? In Roe, so to back up a step, because you can't understand Casey without understanding Roe. So the quick thumbnail sketch. In Roe, the Supreme Court had relied on a penumbral privacy right. You can search through the Constitution. You won't, of course, find the word privacy in the Constitution. The Supreme Court had discerned a right to privacy from certain other constitutional provisions in Griswold and in Eisenstadt versus Baird, and said, well, if this privacy right is sort of hidden in the penumbras of the Constitution, the abortion right must also be included as part of that privacy interest. Roe created a tiered trimester system for how to evaluate abortion claims, and it said that in the first trimester, the right was virtually absolute. In the second trimester, the state could regulate in order to protect health and safety, and in the third trimester, the state's interest became paramount, and abortion could theoretically be prohibited. However, both Roe and Doe came out the same day, and Roe says you have to read them together. And in Doe, you have the explanation from the Supreme Court that when it says there needs to be a health exception for prohibitions on abortion, it's an incredibly broad health exception. That includes, as the court says, familial and emotional health. And what that came to mean in later decisions, and certainly from later decisions from other courts, was essentially if there was no health exception, when you fold it into it, emotional and familial, was essentially a right to unlimited abortion through all 9 months. So I will note as well, though, that in Roe and Doe, and this is something that gets overlooked in the context of our current conscience debates, and we had a case here recently with Mount Sinai Hospital, a nurse who was required to participate in an abortion, and there are cases like that that have gone on around the country. In both Roe and Doe, there's rather strong language that would be supportive of conscience rights in the abortion context. In Roe itself, there's the statement that we don't have to worry that people are going to be compelled to perform or assist in abortions, because even the AMA House of Delegates clearly says that all one has to do is simply refer to someone else and step out of the equation. That's what the AMA House of Delegates had said at the time of Roe. It changed its mind later on, and that has led to a lot of conscience issues. And in Doe, the Supreme Court noted that one particular part of the Georgia law that was not challenged provided protection for the doctor not to have to assist in an abortion. It said, well, if you already have that protection, then anything else is superfluous, because that's an appropriate protection, it said, for the conscience rights of the doctor. So anyway, that's sort of the background on Roe and Doe. A number of cases had come after Roe and Doe, and of course there was sort of some small nibbles taken, particularly through the 80s at Roe. With changes on the court, particularly Justice Rehnquist becoming Chief Justice, Justice Scalia coming onto the court, there was, and Justice O'Connor as well, there was an increasing likelihood, many observers thought, that Roe was going to be overruled. By 1991, when Planned Parenthood versus Casey was heard, that seemed to be, by and large, the accepted belief from most quarters was that it was likely going to be overturned, and the question would be what would replace Casey. And you'll even find in Planned Parenthood versus Casey itself, the discussion in the case, Justice Scalia hints at the fact that, he said rather aggressively, look at what Justice Kennedy and Justice O'Connor have previously said, and they've had to recant their previous statements about Roe in order to reach the conclusion they did. So accepting him at his word, and you can read the opinions for yourself if you look at that part of the Casey opinion and the citations there, there was a very good reason to believe that Casey was going to be the case that overturned Roe. It, of course, did not. But in upholding Roe, the Casey Supreme Court spent very little ink actually attempting to explain why there is a constitutionally protected right to an abortion. It's a very long opinion. I think it's 108 pages that I had printed out earlier. Quite a long judicial opinion. But there's not a whole lot of explanation, real explanation, of why this is a constitutionally protected right. And in upholding Roe, it actually completely changed the ground upon which it seemed to rely. Roe had said that this right, as I mentioned earlier, was a privacy interest. Casey sort of set that as, while saying we are upholding Roe and that's important, it completely changed the ground and said it's actually a liberty interest, and we're changing the terms here. That led, of course, to the mystery passage in Planned Parenthood versus Casey, which you've probably heard before, the right to define oneself, the meaning of life, the universe, and everything. which is either Justice Kennedy or Douglas Adams. I always get those confused, but no one has read Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy? Okay. It's hard to come up with jokes in an abortion debate, so if you could laugh, I would appreciate it. So the court also did away with this trimester framework of Roe, which had been sort of a central piece of Roe. Did away with the trimester framework and instead said that the court said that the state always had an interest in protecting health and safety at any point in the pregnancy, even in the first trimester, which that's a big change from what Roe had done. It acknowledged that the viability line in Roe, where Roe had made viability a critical point, and it acknowledged that this viability line is a moving target, and it's moving backward over time. As science improves, viability changes, and so it's backing up. And it limited the scope of the health exception that was required from this emotional and familial and very broad holding from Doe and Roe, that if the health exception in Pennsylvania was enough. And it said that it only had to, the health exception was for substantial and irreversible physical impairment to a major bodily function, which is a much more limited physical health exception that Casey upheld. So prior to the viability point, states were free to regulate so as long as they did not place an undue burden on the abortion right. An undue burden, of course, was helpfully explained as the imposition of a substantial obstacle, which clarifies everything, right? Undue burden, substantial obstacle, which I think most people read as essentially two sets of words that are just, you're explaining yourself by saying almost the same thing over and over again. Some cases indicate that if you have in order to bring a facial challenge, you have to have this no set of circumstances rule, where if the statute is only to be stricken if there's no set of circumstances in which it would be permissible. But at the very least, after Casey, the court held that it's unconstitutional if in a large fraction of cases in which it's relevant, it will operate as a substantial obstacle to a woman's choice to undergo an abortion. And finally, it held that Roe must be upheld because women had come to rely on abortion, a premise for which there weren't a whole lot of facts in the record at the time. There were discussions, there were amicus briefs, but there weren't a whole lot of facts on this reliance argument. And that the court's own authority to say what the law was at stake. Because if the court was overruling an important precedent like Roe, that people would start to lose confidence in the court. I find that particular result to be disturbing on a number of levels. Particularly the idea that, at a time when we have, even in our sports world, and I'm a sports-focused person, but even in our sports world, there's a focus now on trying to have more and more instant replay, because getting it right is important. And in the Supreme Court context, we have the court telling us that getting it right isn't so important. What's important is that everyone believe that we got it right. So whether or not we think we were right the first time, we can't change what we said before because that would undermine people's confidence in us. I think that's a disturbing place for the court to go. And more so because of the fact that the court itself has aggrandized its own authority as the ultimate arbiter of what the Constitution is. So it's not as if the court gets it wrong, even horrifically wrong, that there's something that Congress could do to fix that, or that any other branch could do to fix that. It's the court can get it wrong, and then it can dig in its heels and say, we may have gotten it wrong, but we're not changing what we said because that would undermine our own authority, and there's nothing that any other branch or any or the people themselves can do to change that result. The court explained that it was doing this because it was calling all sides to stop the fighting and accept the result. Almost this grandiose claim that, people have been divided and now we are bringing some resolution to the abortion question in 1991. That, of course, has worked famously because there are virtually no more abortion debates happening around the country at all. Last election cycle is a perfect proof of that. We've now reached complete nirvana on the abortion question, and it's hardly on the table anymore politically. So ultimately, the court upheld informed consent requirements, a 24-hour waiting period, parental consent provision, and reporting and record-keeping requirements, saying those didn't impose an undue burden. It struck down spousal notification as imposing an undue burden. So what Casey didn't say? It didn't say that a majority of the court thought Roe was correctly decided, or that the Constitution required any abortion right. It implied, in fact, the exact opposite of that. The court says at one point that overturning Roe, because it was error, if error it was, and of course Scalia and in several places the court acknowledges that not everyone here may be in agreement on the ultimate constitutional question, but we are upholding it for this reason for stare decisis. And Scalia calls them out on that in dissent. There was also an edits, the initial slip opinion. You can, if you dig around online, you can find these things. The initial slip opinion that was actually released of the Casey opinion indicates that there were some changes to the voting lineup at the last minute that had not been corrected in the actual slip opinion as it went out. So there, it's corrected in your Westlaw version now. But that's not exactly the same paper copy that was actually handed out. So it appears that the change in the voting lineup was very much last minute in Planned Parenthood versus Casey. It didn't say there is a constitutional right to an unsafe or a less safe abortion. There's no mention of any sort of claim that there is an abortion right that trumps health and safety requirements, for example, in most or any case. It didn't limit state interests that could be asserted beyond health and safety, and as a matter of fact, unlike Roe v. Wade, it in fact said directly that this does not limit the state interest that could be asserted just to health and safety. There are other interests that the state could assert. And it didn't say that courts were to assume that all the claim burdens imposed by a state law were actually entirely attributable to the law itself. Those may seem like odd things. We'll get to why that's important momentarily. In Gonzalez, so more recently, when you were still in high school, but in Gonzalez versus Carhart, the court upheld the Partial Birth Abortion Ban Act with Justice Kennedy, the author of the Casey plurality, writing and saying that the opinion upheld a ban on a type of abortion, including some prior to viability. By the way, it's often thought of as solely a late-term abortion ban, and by all means, it mostly is. But the opinion also recounts the fact that not all of the partial birth abortions that were being banned were post-viability, some were pre, which has, I think, some ramifications for future laws. and it did so with very strong language from Justice Kennedy. Particularly given that he had written the Casey opinion, deferring to Congress despite the absence of any health exception in the law, which supposedly was a requirement from Casey to at least have this narrow health exception, and there was no health exception in that case. He said that the court had deferred to congressional findings because that exception was unnecessary, saying that legislatures must have wide discretion to pass legislation where there is medical and scientific uncertainty. And that sort of brings us to where we are now. There are several current controversies around the country in the abortion context that I think either will be impacted or will themselves impact the Casey decision in a future decision from the court. Those would include sex and race selection abortion provisions that are on the books in some places, particularly Arizona, I'll mention. 20-week or fetal pain laws that are also, I think there are now 13 of those around the country. admitting privileges and similar health and safety standards that are around the country. and RU 486 FDA protocol requirements. So the 20-week fetal pain laws restrict abortion with some exceptions after 20 weeks gestation, where some studies have shown, and we would argue that it's the majority of studies, this is where there's the dispute over whose evidence is right. But the studies show that the fetus will experience pain from an abortion at that point. So the questions that are going to be raised by those laws will be, is there a right to a less safe form of an abortion? Because those statutes also recount the fact that there is a pretty substantial increase in the risk to the woman after about 16 weeks. It's almost parabolic, the risk as you go later into pregnancy. So if that's the case, assume the fact with me for a moment that later term abortions are going to be more dangerous. Can a state restrict later term abortions for that health reason? And how do you compare the state interest in protecting maternal health and the right to an abortion? How do you weigh those? What if a legislature is able to determine that abortions later in pregnancy are substantially more dangerous? Can it restrict or prohibit later term abortions near but before viability, because that had been the key line in Casey, of course, in order to protect women's health? And then ultimately, and this sort of feeds through a lot of these issues, why is abortion entitled to some higher protection from other medical procedures? A lot of these debates that go on around the abortion question are debates that would not be on the table if you were talking about restrictions on or regulations on other types of medical facilities. But when it's in the abortion context, there's a whole separate body of case law that gets applied to those. So why would that be the case? And do you similarly have a constitutional right to other types of medical procedures other than abortion, and that's just not been recognized? Can states restrict abortion prior to viability because of the physical pain to the unborn child and the impact that that could have on the medical profession, confusing the role of the medical profession where medical professionals are doing something that's causing pain, which is not normally in their job description. Race and sex selection and sexual orientation potentially discrimination abortions, can states exercise 14th Amendment authority to say we are empowered by the Constitution to prohibit race and sex discrimination. And so when abortions are being performed for the very purpose of race or gender discrimination, that's something the state can prohibit at any point in pregnancy. You could imagine from this, and there have been some bills that have been offered, the circumstance where the so-called gay gene is discovered. Now what is the state to do? If parents are in fact making abortion decisions based on the fact that the child would end up being or has the propensity to become gay, now what does the state do? Is the state allowed to prohibit abortion in that context? Is that prohibiting discrimination? How do you compare the rights in that context? In a comparable situation in North Dakota, the Down syndrome law that's on the books there now that Planned Parenthood decided not to challenge and dropped from the ongoing lawsuit there. North Dakota is now the first state in the country to prohibit abortion for the purpose of eliminating a Down syndrome child. So those sorts of laws, I think, are going to pose some real questions for courts. RU 486 statutes, this is you have the FDA had approved RU 486 according to a specific protocol, and you have states that are saying we want to restrict the use of RU 486 chemical abortion to just that protocol, and you can't use it off protocol, so you have to use it the way the FDA approved it. That has drawn lawsuits, and it's in fact drawn one Supreme Court cert grant that was later dismissed because of some language about the actual statute at issue. But those laws have now been upheld in Texas by a judge that one would not have expected to have upheld that law in the district court, and then ultimately by the Fifth Circuit as well, and then recently in Arizona as well. And then admitting privileges and other strict health and safety restrictions, if one accepts that those rules would make abortion even slightly safer, how does the abortion right trump those rules? How much safer does the regulation have to be to make the abortion, the burden that's being imposed, undo, to use the court's terminology? So the courts are struggling with those questions now, and in fact, just yesterday, I mentioned this case, an Arizona judge, we've had a flurry of activity in the last week. Just yesterday, an Arizona judge denied an injunction against Arizona's law requiring abortionists to comply with FDA RU486 protocols. The Fifth Circuit, and originally the district court judge, did the same. Supreme Court, as I mentioned, had granted cert previously in that Klein case. On admitting privileges, an Alabama federal judge denied summary judgment yesterday on an admitting privileges law, required that case to go to trial, basically telling Planned Parenthood that they needed to show more proof of their inability to get admitting privileges and attempt to comply with the law. That was a bit of a surprise. The Fifth Circuit had upheld a similar statute just last week, and another in Mississippi is pending. And then there's a case in Wisconsin that's gone the other way and is now back in the trial court that went to the Seventh Circuit and was decided against them in Ben Hollen. The fetal pain and 20-week laws have now been enacted in 13 states, challenged in only three of those. So there are, in fact, 10 states where 20-week fetal pain laws are on the books and have never been challenged and have been in effect, including in Texas, where it was the firestorm of the filibuster, and that was the attention from, and that law was never challenged, and it's been on the books now for about 6 months. Arizona's race and sex selection abortion prohibition was challenged by a branch of the NAACP and an Asian American women's group, but that was dismissed and is now in the Ninth Circuit. So these are all live questions. So to quickly answer the question, I'm going to pass it off. What's the future of Casey? I believe Casey will be short-lived, at least from here. It's already been 20 years. But I think it's an exceedingly unpersuasive opinion. I think it's almost explicit in its admission that it's an exercise of judicial will, not an actual attempt to read the Constitution or to understand the Constitution or interpret it. And as science continues to press the limits of viability, and the court recognizes that or continues in its effort to try to bring peace in the culture wars, and that's failed completely with its prior Casey decision. Increasingly tries to defer to states on these legislative questions, I think Casey's days will be numbered. So the question is, what will replace it? Will it be some limited abortion right the first trimester, like the first draft of the Roe opinion that's now been released? A complete abandonment of Roe, or something else entirely? I don't know the answer to that question, but I think we will probably all know the answer to that sometime in the next 5 or 6 years, because I think some of these cases will be at the court very soon. So.
Thank you for a wonderful overview of the of Casey and of some of the details of where we are in the country since. So this is styled as a debate, and the first part was a lecture and overview. And there are so many things you said with which I agree. Starting immediately with that Casey is a terrible decision. Now we begin to separate pretty quickly, but Casey is a terrible decision, almost laughably so, because the court, whatever the Troika was doing in announcing this compromise, we won't quite explain the wisdom of Roe, but we'll maybe a little bit with our hands tied behind our back, affirm its holding. But now we radically rewrite the rules, and we give a green light to all the red states to enact legislation for the purpose of impeding a woman's right to terminate an unwelcome pregnancy. But the legislators ought not admit that that's the purpose. And what they need to do instead is claim that they care a great deal about the well-being of the mother. And that's created a series of bold, bold lies calculated by lawyers and legislators and anti-abortion individuals throughout the country. It's beyond laughable to make the claim that the legislatures of states like South Dakota have their, or Mississippi or Texas, have as their purpose a commitment to protecting the health and safety of mothers. Preposterous, nobody believes that. But the game requires that that be said, all's we're doing. In 1965, illegal abortion accounted for 17% of all deaths attributed to pregnancy and childbirth. And that vastly understates the actual statistic because it reflects the known deaths from abortion. There were countless more. 38% of low-income women in New York City in 1965 knew a friend or relative who had attempted an abortion. 77% of these women attempted a self-induced procedure. In 1962 alone, 1,600 women were admitted to Harlem Hospital, one hospital, for incomplete abortions. And in the year before Roe was decided, 1 million illegal abortions were performed in this country. Last year, 1 million legal abortions were performed in this country. And there were 8 deaths in the entire country from abortion. This is one of the most important rights that women possess and deserve. And they deserve most of all to have this issue resolved by women. I mean, men have no right telling a person in a context in which a man can never be burdened equally. You had the misfortune to become pregnant? Tough. Get over it. You are, for my purposes, an incubator. And you will, I insist, take care of yourself and make sure the fetus growing in you comes out alive and healthy. Canada, Mexico, the United States, Europe, and Australia all are committed to this freedom for women. Egypt, Libya, Iran, Syria, most of Africa are opposed to it. This is an important part of a series of rights that women have fought for against domination, subordination, and outright exploitation that has been going on for most of American history, for most of history. In 1966, there were 18 convictions for rape in New York City. You know why? Because you couldn't be convicted of rape under the laws of the state of New York without proving, corroborating each and every element of the crime. So a victim's explanation of what happened was insufficient basis upon which to convict. In 2014, in many parts of India, rape victims are subjected to vaginal laxity tests to determine if the rape victim was habituated to sex. The last two sentences that I've uttered come from the New York Times last week. So habituated to sex, I hope you appreciate, was for me stated in quotes. There is a real legacy of subordination of women that a decision like Roe overcomes. We can mock that it was called in 1973 privacy. We could agree that Justice Blackmun's opinion was anything but elegant, stressing the physician's right as much as the woman's. But we've come a long way, baby. And we've now come to appreciate that privacy is better conceived as liberty. And it's the same liberty that gives parents the right to control the details of the upbringing of their children. An unenumerated right that is not found in the text of the Constitution. But neither of us would mock Meyer versus Nebraska or Pierce versus the Society of Sisters, yet both cases actually are the foundation of Roe v. Wade. Now, this is an important issue by any measure for no other reason than that many good people in this country and in this room believe that terminating a pregnancy is an immoral act, a wrongful act. And no end of debate could possibly ignore that or resolve that. But what is necessary in a society that isn't a theocracy, that is committed to pluralism and freedom and best of all, liberty, is the recognition that my belief that your behavior is immoral has nothing to do with my power to enact a law to forbid you from engaging in that behavior. And no better example of that can be found than an even more important decision, Lawrence versus Texas, decided in 2003, in which the court held that each of us possesses the liberty to live our life as we see fit, to engage in sex an intimate physical behavior with a consenting adult without any further regard or inquiry as to who that person may be. Despite the fact that many good people honestly believe that homosexual activity is immoral. To live in freedom means to accept that some people will engage in behavior that you don't like. That's what the essence of pluralism and freedom is. Now, one thing is undisputed, and I heard nothing to suggest otherwise. An abortion is not the termination of a life entitled to 14th Amendment protection. That is a certain truth about American law. We are talking about individuals who are opposed to the freedom to engage in conduct that is believed to be immoral. And the morality often comes from a religious base. But I would think people who are strong believers in religion, above all others, should organize their lives around and be committed to the principle that my duty is to behave the word, the law of God, and to encourage others to do so as well, but to permit others to have a different understanding of God's word. To require that we have the same shared understanding could not conflict more powerfully with the core values of freedom in the United States. There was a time not very long ago, from my perspective, being an old man, when it was illegal for married couples to use contraceptive devices. And Griswold v. Connecticut is Meyer versus Nebraska, Pierce versus Society of Sisters, Wisconsin v. Yoder, Stanley v. Illinois. Lawrence versus Texas. Why was it illegal to use contraceptive devices? Because churchgoers believe that ejaculation is a sin, that copulation for other than purposes of procreation is a sin. And anyone who believes that has every right to believe that. But nobody who believes that has any right to insist that another person live their life according to that principle. There's no difference between forbidding masturbation, ejaculation, copulation. They all go under some version of God's word, of what we're here on earth for. But that's your view, not all people. Termination of life, abortion is not the termination of life entitled to the 14th Amendment protection. Nobody disagrees with that. So what are we talking about? We are talking about the freedom to control one's body, to use the health profession to seek procedures that I want. I want to I want to fix my nose. I want to make my teeth straighter. I want to enhance a part of my body to make somebody be more attracted to somebody. That's who I am. I don't like people like that. I think they're fools. I think they're risking their health for stupid reasons. And I'll fight to the death their right to do it. Because freedom means the freedom to make decisions about one's own body. Women are not incubators. And the belief that abortion is immoral is not something I'm joining issue with. If it is immoral to you, it is immoral. If sleeping with a person of the same sex is disgusting, immoral behavior, I won't argue with you. Just don't stop me from doing what you don't like. That makes you an oppressor and me the oppressed. And we have no right to oppress women through illegality of abortion. And we would have no prohibition against abortion if men couldn't vote on the subject. I'll stop there.
Well, I'll just address a few points because I want to make sure we leave plenty of time for some questions. So, first of all, I want to say at the outset that I oppose rape. I am against it, just to make sure that we have established that point. On a factual point, we don't know the number of deaths from abortion that are happening now. We know what the CDC says, and we know that those statistics are voluntary reporting to the CDC of abortion deaths. We also know that the way that abortion actually happens in this country, there's very little relationship between the abortion doctor and the women. Very often the women are, so if there are complications that occur, the abortion doctor may have absolutely no idea that those were ever occurred in order to even voluntarily report those problems to the CDC. So the 8 statistic is something that we really don't know. It may be close to that. It may be substantially more than that. We don't know. And I've also seen a lot of people taking issue with the prior to 1965 statistics, but setting that aside. The United States has some of the most liberal abortion laws in the entire world. Europe is substantially more conservative on abortion law than the United States is. So we are not simply in the company of Saudi Arabia and North Korea. As a matter of fact, we're exactly the opposite of North Korea and places like China on this question. We are in fact far more liberal than most European countries on the question of abortion, which restrict abortion pretty routinely at 12, 16 weeks. To be having a conversation about a viability line as a critical line before which prohibiting abortion is a significant question is not a conversation that would be happening in Europe, because that's the law in Europe, in most countries in Europe. I will say that I agree that, I'm not sure you would agree, but I will say this. What you just saw is a perfect illustration of exactly where we are. We can attempt to dance around the question all we want to, and we can cite statistics, and we can talk about legal theories and all sorts of things. Ultimately, the question becomes, what is that thing? Is it a person? Is it a future person? Is it just an appendage? What is the thing growing inside a woman when she is pregnant? To me, that is a critical, critical question, because if there is no answer to that question, if it's purely a philosophical question that can't be answered with any amount of scientific research or in any other way, then you get to a lot of the same debates we have that you're seeing here. To me, if there is in fact a scientific answer to that question, if there is an actual answer to that question, then I think that leads you to some consequences of that decision. I find it fascinating that in the abortion context, we act as if there is one medical fact that can never possibly be known. And it's a question that in Roe, the court had to say, well, we just can't possibly know. And in Casey, you have the mystery passage, as if this is not an answerable question, as if textbooks don't help us at all on deciding what is this thing. I think they do, and I think they pretty clearly say that this is a person, and the state has an interest in that person. So whether it's a person for constitutional purposes, 14th Amendment, because particularly because the 14th Amendment says born, whether it's a person for that purpose or not, for a state to say that this is a person, whether born or not, and that the state has an interest in these people, is, I think, something that you have to come to a conclusion on. And if you come to an actual conclusion, and I think, frankly, the court should be able to entertain that question in the exact same way that they entertain legal questions all the time, factual questions all the time. Let's have an actual determination of what this thing is, because that's the elephant in the room in the abortion debate. As to the quote, and I would butcher it if I attempted to actually give the actual quote, so I hope I don't. But basically, the principle was that my belief that what you're doing is wrong does not give me the right to say that you can't do it. I think that's a very dangerous principle. It sounds very nice in the abstract. It sounds good. It's the kind of thing that people think, well, yeah, we can just have this sort of just because I think something is wrong doesn't mean people shouldn't be able to do that thing, particularly if the reason I think it's wrong is because it comes from a religious belief, which, of course, and I'm glad you pointed out that not everyone does. Secular Students for Life, for example, would be quite upset by that idea. The reason I think that's a really dangerous principle is you don't have to look back very far, as a matter of fact, in case law, to see examples of where that went horribly wrong. In Dred Scott, the court was addressing what I think is a very, very similar question to the one that was at issue in Roe versus Wade. The court, in fact, said that there was a property interest, not the liberty prong, but a property interest, and that there was a property interest in slaves, and that slaves were not, in fact, really people. They were inferior, and they had that on the authority of and so therefore there was in fact a constitutional right to own slaves, drawn from the fact that slaves were treated as inferior by the Constitution. So there was constitutional reasoning for the idea that slaves were inferior, in addition to philosophy, you had philosophers making the same point. You had science supposedly making the argument that scientifically African Americans are not the same as whites, and so therefore they are inferior and can't possibly be entitled to the same constitutional protection. Someone making that the exact same claim would have been making a perfectly valid legal argument before the Supreme Court in Dred Scott, and that was the claim that won the day in Dred Scott. So I think there is a real concern about saying that just because I say something is wrong does not mean that it's in fact wrong. I think you ultimately have to get back to the question, what is this thing? And if it's a person, if it's a separate, unique human life, which the Eighth Circuit said, in fact, it is, as a factual matter, that's a truth. If it's a separate, unique human life, then we have to go from there and decide, okay, well, in light of that fact, now what do we do? But to simply skirt around that and act as if we can just say that, look, if que sera, sera. If I say it's wrong, that just applies to me and doesn't apply to you. Or men have no say in what is a substantial question that has affected 55 million lives in this country since Roe v. Wade. Is I think those are nice talking points, but I think they missed the mark rather substantially. I would note that in fact it was religious people who led the fight in the abortion, or in the Dred Scott, the slavery debates, as William Wilberforce who led those fights. So the mere fact that someone is informed by religious faith in order to make their arguments does not take them out of the public sphere. And I don't think you would make that claim. But there is a history, both in really throughout the entire civil rights movement, of religious people making claims that were respected as perfectly legitimate claims to be made in the public sphere. This is a brand new argument, really, in our nation's history, that if your argument is informed by religious faith, it's somehow less entitled to be heard. I think it's an argument that would surprise people like Martin Luther King, for example. So with that said, you have another few minutes, and then we can take some questions.
My point about morality becoming law, particularly when it has to do with the regulation of sexual activity, is that our laws originally were Puritan, religious-based, codifying biblical understandings. And a modern United States has rejected that heritage as a sufficient basis for upholding a law. Otherwise, in Connecticut, married couples couldn't have used contraceptives without breaking the law. And homosexual acts today would still result in people being prosecuted and imprisoned. Justice Scalia was horrified at the idea that morality is no longer a sufficient basis for making something illegal. But he was in the minority. Justice Kennedy said in response that it is an insufficient reason to proscribe another person's conduct that some segment of society wishes they didn't do it. The elephant in the room of what is a fetus is not as complicated as has been suggested. The undeniable truth is that this pre-born, this future person, cannot survive without the will of the organism in which it is growing. And that is the point, that you may not oppress an individual, a woman, by insisting that she live her life according to what you would want her to do for no better reason than you think it would be wrong for her to do otherwise. That's the point. You know, we count ages of fetuses today in an odd way. We count it as from the beginning of the last period, usually about 2 weeks older than the fetus actually is. So when you're 13 weeks pregnant, by doctor's count, the embryo is usually 11 weeks old and a day or two. ...95% of the abortions performed in this country are performed before 15 weeks is up. And if you take about 2 weeks below that, you're down to 13. So if we grasp this great issue, which has created a boondoggle for legislators who get to get elected by enacting laws that they know will be struck down by federal courts in order to reaffirm the idea that we're living in a country that's lawless, controlled by a judiciary. It's a game that works. That's why Casey is a miserable decision, because it didn't take heed of Justice Jackson's brilliant insight in West Virginia School Board against Barnett, in which he said the Constitution exists on purposefully to take some issues above the fray of democracy where they don't belong, and personal liberty, and the freedom to say, darn, I wish I weren't pregnant. Oh, I'm a free adult who can make decisions about my own life. Okay, I'm going to end this pregnancy. Thank you very much. I don't care if you're happy or sad that I'm doing that. That's what it means to live in a free society.
All right, so we're moving on to questions.
I have a question. This would be for you, I guess.
Sure.
I wonder, first of all, I guess going off of the last rebuttal, why the pro-life side emphasizes so much late-term abortions when that's not really an issue and not so much what's being discussed or what the majority of situations are. And also, secondly, does it matter what the definition of a life or when a life begins is? Because I believe that it shouldn't matter whether an embryo is considered a person or not, if it's within 2-4 weeks, even 6 weeks, something of when I've missed my period, whether or not I can have an abortion. So is that what's fundamental to this question or not? And if not, then what is the fundamental point of argument?
So, first of all, Casey sets sort of the parameters of the debate that you can have, right? Roe and Casey set the parameters of the debate you can have. So, yes, you can't walk in and say, you know, state decrees that no more abortions shall occur, because those would be struck down, and your point would be valid as to those, about legislatures that are creating laws that they know will be struck down. As to the laws that are actually being enacted, the point's not valid because, in fact, Planned Parenthood hasn't even challenged, for example, the 20-week laws that are on the books in 10 states because they know they will be upheld, or they substantially fear they will be upheld. We have quotes from them saying, we're not challenging those laws because we don't want to create a circuit split and get that to the Supreme Court. So, yes, it's not as many abortions are being, you can look at it the other way, right? On one hand, it's, you don't actually care about women's health. Everyone knows that's a lie. Why are they restricting only abortions that are late in pregnancy that that are after the point at which women's health is most at risk from those abortions, which in fact may actually just cause women to have abortions earlier, because that's not having much of an impact. Maybe the charitable way to look at that is, in fact, maybe there is something to the idea that some of these states are in fact interested in women's health. But as to your second question on sort of the that big question about what this thing is, from the perspective of the state, I think it does ultimately matter. I think morally it makes a difference as to, you know, if this is, you know, what this is. But I think from the perspective of a state, if the state says, look, we're not trying to protect, it's not like we're trying to protect tumors, right? This isn't, you know, what this is not just tissue, it's not part of your body, it's not, this is a separate person, then from the perspective of the state, there's an interest there. I think to the, you know, sort of expand it the other way. When the question is raised, well, how would that before birth, particularly pre-viability, that, you know, the fetus wouldn't be able to support itself, to live on its own. Well, neither can my two-year-old. I have a two-year-old son that if I left him at home over the weekend, I would probably return to find him dead. What does that prove? That this is, he is dependent upon demands upon my and my wife's body all the time, late at night, early in the morning, throughout the day. If the refrigerator door is closed, he would die of starvation because he cannot open the refrigerator door, at least yet. That may change by the time I'm home, but we're getting close to that point. But to simply make that, this is the problem. When you start making the claim that the critical dividing line is either birth, I think that's fraught with all sorts of problems. And you can say as emphatically as you want to, but it's fraught with problems. And if you make the dividing line, even the viability question, you note that there's this two-week situation with exactly, you know, determining when your pregnancy is. And for those who have been pregnant, you know this, trying to decide exactly when your due date is an art more than a science, or is as much of an art as a science. And you know that there's a period in there that's roughly the time when you're due. It's because you can't quite pinpoint these things. And so to have a viability determination that determines life or death, that's a specific day, is, you know, and then it becomes sort of a Schrodinger's cat situation too. I mean, no one has ever been able to decide this is not a viable fetus, so therefore we can abort, and then after the fact determine were we right or wrong, because you've now destroyed the evidence that would have allowed you to be able to have any idea, were we correct, was it viable, was it not viable. So having that viability dividing point is creates its own set of problems.
I realize that reasoning by analogy isn't ideal, but it seems to me that there is a fundamental difference between your two-year-old who isn't physically, literally tied to you physically, relying on your blood and your eating patterns and whether or not you drink alcohol and constantly day in, day out. There's a fundamental difference there. I would just like you to respond to that, because from my perspective, it almost is irrelevant whether or not a fetus is a person. If it can't survive without, like, actually surviving inside of another person, then the state has no ability to chain that person to the other person.
Right. So you have sort of the example that's often given is that you wake up and you find yourself connected by an IV to someone that's been brought in, and you're told, look, this other person is going to die if we detach you. And so that's an often used hypothetical, and there are about 10 different responses to it. And I won't go through all 10 responses to that. But I think to me, one of the most significant ones is the fact that, setting aside the rape situations, it's not an apt analogy, because the person in that scenario has done something that has actually put the person in that consequence, right? So it would be more similar to that scenario would be something more like, you know, you have done something to cause your three-year-old child to be in the hospital, and you're told he needs your blood transfusion in order to live. And you decide, well, but bodily autonomy, I don't have to give my three-year-old child my blood. You may be right as a matter of bodily autonomy, but I think most of us would look at that and think, but morally, that doesn't seem right. If you have actually caused the three-year-old to be in this scenario, and so when someone is pregnant, that, you know, I guess setting aside immaculate conception, there's a reason why one is pregnant other than the rape scenario. So again, setting that off the table, and so that's. There's a different moral calculus, I think, from the typical scenario of the you wake up and find yourself connected to someone sort of scenario, which is you're part of this, not an independent observer who just happens to be connected to this thing. So, and that's one possible answer to that.
So I want to talk a little, I would like you to talk more about, I'm not going to talk about what is what do you need to pass laws? If the belief that something is morally wrong is not enough, what else do you need? And don't we see laws being passed based solely on the fact that the larger portion of the population feels something wrong?
I think we've gotten away from that, and Lawrence is the key case that has come close to ending that. So same-sex marriage is an example from another direction where the court ended up saying, well, the state courts, the Supremes haven't quite said it yet. Other than the idea that we don't like it, we can't identify a legitimate justification for its prohibition. And that becomes, so it has to be other than the idea that you don't like it. That's what I mean when I say based only on your sense of morality. It's not enough. You have to show that it violates another person's right, right? So we can restrict my going through a traffic light when it's red for obvious reasons. We can restrict my stealing for obvious reasons. My taking another life. They happen to be moral principles found in the Ten Commandments, of course. But they are also legitimate secular purposes. There is none in the abortion context when you isolate the sense of moral belief that you're doing something unacceptable. You are not infringing on a right, on a person's right, when you terminate a pregnancy. The mother of the two-year-old does not have to care for her child. That's a false claim. She can abandon her child. She can say, I never want to see you again. And it's not a crime. And it's probably an immoral, unfortunate act. And it's lawful. And we'll take care of the kid if we are lucky, right? We'll find a home for the two-year-old who has been abandoned. It's not true that parents have a duty to care for their children. They have a duty not to harm their children because their children are people with constitutionally protected rights.
Yeah, I'll just sit. I think this is a better situation anyway. So first of all, I'm glad you agree that a parent abandoning a two-year-old is an immoral thing to do, or at least would be deemed by some to be an immoral thing to do. And in fact, there are child abandonment laws that are on the books, but you're correct that there are...
No. Actually, there are no child... It is not a crime for me to give my child to a social service
agency. Yes, right. Those are Baby Moses laws,
well, the,
right?
The abandonment you're talking about is leaving a child in the Nile River to risk
right.
death. That's a
different
thing. It is
right.
not illegal to abandon your child. In fact, we encourage parents to abandon their children if they think it's better for their children
and
not
those,
to raise them.
Those laws that have allowed that have been largely since Roe and were largely the result of pro-life lawmakers who have, in responding to the claim that there was nothing for a parent to do, have said, we will create Baby Moses laws that will provide for that. Those laws have come largely since Roe and were a response to that exact argument. But to back up on this morality point about the law and the fact that you have this idea that you shouldn't be able to legislate based on morality, I mean, just to clarify here, the laws that we're actually talking about that are going to pose the question for Casey are not laws that say, because the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob said, thou shalt not commit murder, it is hereby prohibited to have abortions in the state of Mississippi. I don't know of language drafted that way. What you're actually seeing are things like fetal pain laws that are based on science. You have admitting privileges laws that say it's better for a woman who is having an abortion to have an abortion with an abortionist who has the ability to get her admitted to a local hospital and participate in her care at that hospital. That's not a morality-based decision. That's a regulation of an abortion procedure based on evidence and facts. You have sexual discrimination laws, or sex discrimination laws, gender discrimination laws, that are also in the books. Those are not based on morality unless we deem sex discrimination to be just a question of morality. But we have those laws pretty frequently. So anyway, this is, to clarify, we're not talking about simply moral-based decisions. Just because it's in the abortion context, we don't get to pretend that there's no real actual statistics, numbers, and research that are going into any of these laws, and that they're for no purpose other than opposition.
I'll say it before it's over, but let's hear more.
I just had a question regarding, you mentioned the 14th Amendment, and I sort of, preliminary matter, I'm curious what part of the 14th Amendment you felt empowered the states to do anything. But beyond that, to both of you, if kind of pointing out the Dred Scott decision that really focused on what makes a citizen, and you very rightly pointed out that citizenship is defined in the 14th Amendment by birth. And so under the 14th Amendment aren't, if not unborn fetuses, therefore not either not entitled to any constitutional protection, or at a minimum, certainly a lesser extent than, you know, a living, breathing woman.
Right, and I guess what I would say is, first of all, I mean, whether or not it's a person or not, whether or not it's entitled to constitutional protection doesn't mean the state doesn't have an interest in protecting. I mean, the animals aren't people under the 14th Amendment, and that doesn't mean that states have no, or therefore devoid of any interest in prohibiting prohibiting people from mistreating animals, right? So the mere fact that it's not protected by the 14th Amendment directly as a constitutional matter doesn't mean that it's off the table altogether.
No, but you can't prioritize the rights of a dog over the rights of a human being.
Right, well,
the dog doesn't have that same level of protection.
But you're denying the right of a woman to terminate an unwelcome pregnancy. It's the right does not exist, is the claim.
Yeah, I mean, the point is, you know, and even in Roe itself, I mean, there's recognition that the state has an interest, even in the, at least at some point prior to birth, in order to be able to tell a woman, no, not after this point, you can't have an abortion. And Casey certainly recognizes the power of the state to be able to make that same argument. So it's not a prioritization of. It's not as if the state is trying to decide who lives and who dies between woman and child. It's a question of death on one side, or destruction of whatever this thing is, this potential life, future life, or life, and the impairment of the woman's interests. But it's not as if the interests impaired are not identical interests, right? I mean, you're talking about total destruction or impairment. Hopefully that helps a little bit.
People
in the
old days.
Well, they do, and so typically there are life exceptions that are made to laws. You will find that it is incredibly rare, I mean exceedingly rare, that there are actually abortions for that purpose. I mean, you'll go through, for example, I mean, the Hyde Amendment has the life exception. You can look through, so those could be Medicaid-funded abortions, and you can ask state after state after state, please provide me with the number of people who actually received life abortions under that provision, and you'll get states saying, we've never had any of those before.
Isn't it sort of perverse to require women until they're at death's door before they can get an abortion, rather than allowing having earlier and more safer?
Right. Well, right. The point is that doesn't occur very frequently at all. Right. So my point is that it's a theoretical claim that you have life, the need for life exceptions. It's more theoretical than it is reality.
We think about the safety advantages gained by most of these abortion restrictions. I mean, a lot of this is all very theoretical.
I mean, except for you have state legislatures that have actually made determinations that it's pretty clear, and the Gosnell case, I think, pretty clearly demonstrates that there is a need for health and safety restrictions on abortion clinics, because if they don't...
Sure, I think we can agree that Gosnell goes over the line, but right. I don't think that speaks much to what states have done before or since Gosnell. I think we can truly agree that state legislatures do come with poor decisions from time to time. I mean, I'm from Albany, so right. I think I can speak to that.
I will stipulate to that, yes.
On your earlier comments that there's no reason other than moral reasons for being having these laws prohibiting abortion, because we're talking specifically about like stopping at a red light or not, but that's not purely moral because it's infringing on the rights of another person. But I think that's exactly what this abortion debate is about, because if you define that fetus as another person, now you do have a non-religious reason to advocate against abortion rights. So can you then clarify then reasons?
I reject the claim that we are talking about a person. We are talking about an embryo that will become a person with the cooperation and voluntary acts of the organism in which it is growing. A woman with the constitutional right to request medical procedures to help her live the life she chooses to live. And I simply reject the idea that an embryo is a person. If I, and to the extent we're calling that the elephant in the room, so be it. That is, there isn't a great deal to say about it. But, you know, the pro-life movement shouldn't be called pro-life. It should be called anti-choice, because the pro-choice movement is a pro-life movement. And the title one gets to call oneself in this context should mean the opposite of the other side. And to call the pro-choice movement anti-life is a slander. To call the pro-life movement anti-choice is accurate. Once you are talking about a person and a person, it is reasonable, I believe, for the state to place some limits on the unfettered freedom to make decisions. So now you might have to justify the decision. That might mean having to explain the psychological meaning to you of being pregnant and something, but to leave it where it is now, that I needn't explain why, I just want it, probably would go too far when we're talking about at the expense of a person.
No, I mean, I think ultimately we can, we as I said before, we dance around a lot of issues, but I think ultimately for each of us personally, and I think for the law, it ultimately becomes a question of, is this an answerable question? And then what's the answer to the question? Is it even possible to answer the question what these things are? And then if it's possible to answer that question, then we need to get to an answer to the question and then see where the law leads us after that point. But to pretend that that there's sort of one unanswerable question in all the law, you have theological questions and what is that particular thing, one particular medical thing that we can't possibly answer the question on? I think we don't do ourselves a service by acting like that, and I think it leads you to the controversies you see in law and politics today, that we pretend that this is not an answerable question instead of trying to have a fair attempt to reach the answer. This is a very religious song that's playing.
Any other questions?
You mentioned earlier that you think the state of science currently does point to a fairly clear answer on the question of whether or not it's a person. But then you also brought up in discussing Scott correctly that contemporary science was deeply entrenched in a lot of racist ideas about, you know, who counted as a person and what the differences between the people were. I was wondering if you could speak to why you accord science authoritative weight now,
Right. I would certainly ask that question of those who support abortion rights, who are constantly saying that the folks who support, who are on the pro-life side, and I would use the term pro-life, are in fact not interested in science. But you can go back and forth with that, right? I mean, it's an objective fact that historically there's been I think we give too much credit to science as a society, as if, you know, well, if science has ever said, then it therefore must be true that, all of us see the, depending on the week, we find out whether or not it's a good thing to have salt or a bad thing to have salt, and they go back and forth on studies on this sort of thing every day. But on the question of, so what is this thing inside a woman, it's pretty clear that it's a separate, unique human being, as the Eighth Circuit said. The question is whether you call that human. I mean, that it's a part of the human species, right? And it's not the same as the person in whom, where it's living. It has a separate DNA structure. So from there, what do you do with that piece of information? Do you call it a person? Do you not? The person term is really where the controversy is. There's actually not any controversy about whether or not it's a human being. It's a human being in exactly the same way that an elephant before it's born is an elephant. It's just an unborn elephant. It's not some other species. I think you're right that science has made errors in the past. I completely agree with that, and I point to those for the very fact that we can't or we shouldn't defer completely to science. But I think there are a lot of very clear scientific facts that we can draw that make a pretty clear determination that what we're dealing with is a separate human being. And I think that's from there we need to decide what we do with these things and what their rights are and what people's claims on them are.
Any more questions?
Once you enter personhood, it becomes a very difficult debate. It becomes difficult to sustain abortion, I guess, if we're counting the fetus as a person. But I was wondering how you are able, or where you would draw the line, because it seems to be that's a fundamental distinction that there should be a line drawn somewhere. And I don't know where it would be drawn, because when I think about the different lines of birth or viability, they do seem somewhat problematic.
Well, they are somewhat. I agree. I'm comfortable with the trimester or 15-week arrangement that says a woman has unfettered freedom to get out of this through a certain point in the progression of the growth of the fetus. And that after that, it would be regulated. The flaw in Casey for me is that the court urged states to regulate abortion from day one, knowing that the states who would bother doing it are anti-abortion. So they set into motion a process that now is driven by lawyers who pretend that it's about safety and welfare of mothers. And it's stuff and nonsense. It's anti-abortion. What the Casey court should have said is what Justice Blackmun said in the dissent on this point, that a fundamental right, which was upheld in Casey, may not be impeded except upon a compelling state interest. And that would have protected women's rights in the way I would support. But after viability, maybe after the first 15 weeks, I would say, regulating abortion is consistent. It does further the state's interest.
So, I mean, I guess what I would say there, are you saying then that any kind of health and safety regulations prior to 16 weeks should be off the table? For example, having the health department be able to go in and inspect and make sure that basic health requirements are being followed. They did inspections in Virginia, for example, And in every last clinic in Virginia, this is the first time they'd been inspected in forever, and in every last clinic in Virginia, they found a deficiency of some kind. There were blood splattered on examining room tables. There were pieces of fetuses that were in the bottom of the refrigerator that was used for food. There was, you had all these sorts of issues, right, that the health department could address.
What I'm saying with respect is that's a lot of crap.
Those are facts from the findings.
I know, but the interest was like the food inspector that wants to give the restaurant a bad grade. The interest was to close the place. Look, West Virginia and Texas require that women be told that getting an abortion carries a risk of infertility. It does not. Alaska, Kansas, Mississippi, Oklahoma, Texas, and West Virginia require that women be told that getting an abortion carries a heightened risk of getting breast cancer. It does not. In Michigan, that you have a heightened risk of becoming depressed. That's not true. South Dakota, that you're a greater risk of suicide. This is anti-abortion legislation dressed in the artful garb of lawyer rhetoric that pretends it's about women's well-being. Stuff and nonsense. Abortion today is safe. Let the medical profession regulate it. Don't run out of town the doctors willing to provide it. Don't make it hard. Make it easy. Make it friendly. And it will be safe. But that is the last thing those legislatures have any interest in doing.
Okay, so first of all, there is, in fact, a risk of infertility with abortion. That's demonstrably true.
What method of abortion?
Well, so particularly from surgical abortion, right? Surgical abortion particularly, if you have...
Surgical abortion isn't necessary. Right.
And almost right. Never done. D&Cs are the method.
Right. So, but the...
And there's no risk.
There is, in fact, a risk of infertility from having an abortion.
From the DNC.
There are demonstrable studies on this. It sounds good and there's lots of great talking points, but the courts have found exactly the opposite because they actually have the studies in front of them that support the evidence. The Breast Cancer Institute also points out that continuing a pregnancy reduces your risk of breast cancer. So this question of does abortion cause breast cancer is a little bit of a confusing question. From the perspective of someone who is presently pregnant and trying to decide what to do, if you continue a pregnancy to term, it decreases your risk of breast cancer. That's from, you can go to the US government website and find statistics on that fact. And there have been a number of studies done all over the world that have supported the exact same thing. This idea that we're driving doctors out of town, a predominant way in which abortion occurs in a large part of the country is that you line up a long series of abortions that are all done on one day, every 10 to 15 minutes, and they will have a doctor come in from out of state, and they do abortions one after the other. That's the response, the situation to which states are responding with these admitting privileges laws to say, no, you can't have this out-of-state person with no connection to these women flying in, doing abortions, leaving, and not being able to be there for any follow-up. So the idea you're driving doctors out of town, in many cases, the doctors are in fact out of town, and they're flying in for the purpose of doing
abortions. Why are they out of town?
Because no one wants to do abortions.
Oh, no one wants to do abortions. I get it.
Because the abortion industry will tell you that they have a real problem finding people who are actually interested.
Why do they have a real problem finding people willing to perform abortions?
The reason they have a difficult time finding people who want to do abortions is the same reason that it's difficult to find lawyers who want to do DUI cases. Because it's not thought of as, even in the medical profession, as the kind of thing that people want to go into.
DUI lawyers.
Yeah, and that's, statistically.
It's a safe thing to do, right?
No, right. It's a wonderful talking point. It's an incredibly rare occurrence.
I mean, most assassinations are.
That's a great talking point. Congratulations.
It's
then that your argument is actually that the legislature's goal is purely for the health and well-being of a pregnant woman, to say that to require that they be informed of all the risks of the abortion, but none of the risks of pregnancy, for example. It just seems to me that if their goal were that, that the regulations would look entirely different than they do.
And in most cases, they are being informed of all the risks of pregnancy, because it's in the abortionist's financial interest to make sure that they know of the risks of pregnancy.
That's in the legislature?
No, it's the abortionist.
But the legislature doesn't see fit to say
that
because
they're providing all that information.
And in most of the statutes, they are the informed consent requirement includes the requirement that you provide full information about all the options, right? Those are being, including continuing pregnancy to term.
So to be clear, you actually think that's the goal of the legislation?
I certainly do think that these statutes are being enacted in order to protect women.
Protect them from what is, I guess, what I'm getting at. Protecting them from incurring some kind of health, negative health results.
Exactly.
Okay.
Negative health consequences from abortion, that particularly with informed consent, you have routine cases in which women simply did not know information about their abortions, and so it's critically important that people actually have full knowledge. These are often situations where women, the only medical professional they actually see is an abortionist. They often have a typical abortion situation as a woman who doesn't have the doctor that she goes to frequently. And this is the one time she's in a doctor's office in a very long time, and it's important for her to actually know what all the possible risks are. And we do that in virtually every other setting, but in the abortion context, it becomes politicized and it becomes idealized. And it's not just it's not as if it's the pro-life legislators who are inserting ideology into these things, and the information that the woman is already being provided by the abortionist is completely ideologically neutral. It's the other side of the conversation that the woman is being informed of.
So previously when you were talking about how pregnancy happens because people have sex, setting aside rape cases, are you saying that anytime a woman gets pregnant, she has to carry that that pregnancy to birth, even if that person uses all birth control methods? Like abstinence is the only way, or you have to carry the pregnancy all the way?
Look, I mean, I am pro-life. What I am saying is that laws that are being enacted that I'm actually was here to talk about, I think, are constitutionally sound. That's a whole separate moral question that one could have. That's a whole totally separate issue, right? But we are not anywhere close to a point where the Supreme Court is going to say that there is that it is constitutionally permissible to simply prohibit all abortions altogether. I don't think we're anywhere close to that. So I mean, it's a hypothetical. Hypothetical question, but I don't think it has any real.
So I meant to stay with the legal side. So thank you. Let me specify maybe more. So if you say that the Supreme Court is not going to go to the point of saying no abortions whatsoever, what are the points that you think it will allow?
Well, I mean, what would happen? I mean, imagine, for example, that the Supreme Court actually overturns Roe completely. First of all, I have a hard time imagining it would overturn Roe completely and not still provide for some constitutional protection in some limited circumstances, and the typical exceptions, the rape, incest, life of the mother type situation. Anyway,
why?
Can I point to any point in the text that would support that? No, I can't. I also can't point to any point in the text that would support Roe.
I don't see how you could justify it.
But
you're taking a human life.
Right. I'm just saying, it would not surprise me if the Supreme Court did that. But ultimately,
but it shouldn't, right? That would go too far. That would be an unenumerated right made up by justices.
Right.
and causing the death of a person.
I'm not supporting it.
And you're against it.
What I'm saying is you would then go to the states, right? And these questions would be basically hashed out on state level, not on the federal level. And in a number of states, you have state constitutional protections on the abortion right that are even broader than the federal protection. You have state statutory protections. You would also have the potential for federal legislative action. That would
How can you have a state constitutional protection to kill a human life?
How can you have a federal constitutional protection to kill a human life?
You can't, according to you.
What? I don't think I understand. But, I mean, my point is, this is what I expect would happen, right? Where we would end up being is we would be back at the state level having many of the same conversations, but on state levels, not on the federal level.
You mean it would be lawful to allow abortions in the United States? Really? That wouldn't be criminal?
Unless you had a Supreme Court decision saying there's a 14th Amendment right to life of the unborn child, right? Then yes, you'd go back to the states. That's the import of overturning Roe versus Wade, right? I mean, you agree with that?
That would be the import.
Okay.
But it...
Any more questions? Well, time for one more. No? Okay, well, I would like to thank both of our speakers for coming. And there's still plenty more sushi, so just go ahead and enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.